Good evening. It's time to begin our Sunday evening worship service. Glad to see everyone out with us this evening. If you're visiting, we're especially glad that you're here. And if you would, please take just a moment to fill out one of the blue visitor's cards. Pass those towards the center aisle. In just a moment, we'll have the ushers come around and pick those up. A quick update on Pam Rosenbloom. Carrie took her back to the hospital this evening. They're not completely sure, since coming back from Nevis, they're not exactly sure what she has. So they're going to do some other stuff, but let's keep Pam in our thoughts and prayers. Ladies Helping Hands, remember you're going to go to Fall Mills on Tuesday, June 25th. Please pick a picnic lunch and meet at the building at 10 o'clock and enjoy a day of fun and fellowship. Also, Helping Hands, remember your project is Medicines for Honduras. All Honduras team members will meet in the fellowship hall Wednesday night for class for final preparations for the trip. Service Team 6 and the teens will be fellowshipping tonight at the Mitchell's home. That'll be after services this evening. They ask that you bring comfortable clothes and or a lawn chair. Also, please bring your favorite finger food or dessert and a drink. And if you want to play paintball, a group is going this Saturday. They're going to leave the building at 7:50 a.m. The cost is $44. There's a sign-up sheet for this activity. And also, if you're interested in kayaking down the Flint with the youth group sometime this summer, please sign the list on the bulletin board. They're just trying to gauge some interest to see who would like to participate in that activity. Would the ushers pick up any visitors' cards that we have? Our third annual Fire and Ice will be coming up on a week from Wednesday. That'll be July 1st, immediately after Wednesday evening services. If you're not familiar with this activity, we have fireworks and everybody brings homemade ice cream. It's a really good time. If you would like to donate money for the fireworks show, please give that to Carrie or Steve Bramlett. Tonight, our opening song is number 602. 602, our closing prayer will be led by Taylor Watson, and our opening prayer by Don Dukemanier.
Let us pray. Our Father and our God in heaven, we are thankful for this day. We are thankful for the blessing of life. We're thankful for tonight and another opportunity to come together, to open up our Bibles, to study another message from your word, to sing songs of praise, and to have this avenue of prayer with you. We're thankful for this opportunity to become stronger together, that as we go out into our work weeks, to our jobs, we're around family and friends, that we will be better examples to those around us. We are so thankful for your Son and our Savior and the sacrifice that he made on the cross, dying to save us from our sins. God, that there are those that have been mentioned tonight that are in need of our prayers. We pray for Sister Pam as she continues to struggle after returning from a trip, and as the doctors are searching and trying to discover what may be possibly wrong, and we pray that you be with them. Be with Carrie and the family as they comfort her, to allow her to take it easy and to rest and be comfortable. God, we're also mindful of those who have lost loved ones recently, with the Jones and the Elkins and the Helms family. We pray that you continually place your hand of comfort upon them, that as they grieve, they know that their loved ones are in a better place, that they're no longer hurting or no longer struggling. God, we also pray for those that have not been mentioned, that we know of, that are in our minds and on our hearts, those who may be struggling with things or those who are trying to overcome something. We pray that you will strengthen them, be with them as they struggle with these situations, and that they will turn to you for guidance and direction. God, we continue to pray for this church and the blessing and the role that it plays here in this community, that as individuals, as we make up our family, that we continue to be examples to those who don't show up on a regular basis, who don't attend at all, that they know that if they have problems or dealing with unfortunate situations, that they can turn to us for comfort. God, we pray for the elders and the deacons here as they make decisions for this congregation, that you will give them the wisdom and the correct judgment to make the best decisions to further establish our church. God, we pray for those who serve our community as well, our police, our fire, our first responders, even those here among our congregation who sometimes put their lives on the line or go into situations of danger. We pray that you watch over and protect them as they go in these situations. God, we pray now as we go into this worship service that we will clear our mind of outside things and that we'll focus on the message that Tim brings tonight and that we will pay close attention to better strengthen our spiritual walks. Be with us. Guide, guard, and direct our footsteps. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Number 602, sing the first and third verse. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful Father above, we shall
Number
473. Sing the first and second verse. 473.
There is a name I love to hear.
Number 821. Sing the first and third stanzas, please.
Oh, the blessed rock of ages,
of ages I am trying.
Where?
230. Number 230. We'll sing all three verses in number 230.
Hide me, O my Savior, hide me in thy
number 336. Number 336 will be our song of encouragement after the lesson this evening. Now number 694. Number 694. We'll sing the first, second, and fifth stanzas. If you'll stand, if you can, stand where you are, and we'll sing first, second, and fifth stanzas.
To Canaan's land, I'm on my way, where the soul never dies. My darkest night will turn to day, where the soul never dies. No where all is given by, and the soul.
What a fitting song to introduce our discussion tonight. To Canaan's land, I'm on my way, where the soul of man never dies. Appreciate Brother Steve leading us in our singing tonight. We hate that Brother Carey is not with us, and certainly hope that Pam's situation is resolved quickly and effectively, and that they are back with us in our place. Tonight we'll be spending our time in Luke chapter 12 in our discussion. We're going to start, though, with a reading from Mark chapter 4 before we get to that spot, but we'll be headed in that direction. Jesus taught in parables. That concept is expressed many times throughout the New Testament. Luke is full of parables. In the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, the 33rd verse says, "And with many such parables he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. But without a parable he did not speak to them, and when they were alone he explained all things to his disciples." I have a book in my library, and it's entitled, Without a Parable. It's a wonderful little discussion about Jesus, his ministry, the work that he did, and the very special place that parables hold. They are endearing. They are rich illustrations of life. They just beg examination and application to life. The comparisons that you get for your time in reading them is just marvelous. Some of the parables of Jesus are truly beloved. Luke records several that are not found in the other Gospels. Certainly Luke chapter 10 would be one of those, with the discussion of the Good Samaritan. And in a few weeks we'll be talking about the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15. And that also is a very special place. They make our hearts glow and really feel compassion. Often they call us to do an example. Go and do likewise. Not the one tonight. Tonight's parable in Luke chapter 12 is a big sign. Yellow and black, bold letters, warning, caution, red flashing lights. If you're traveling along the roadway and you don't know where you are, when you come to an area that's got a steep turn or something else, and when the highway department has put out the signs that mark the turns, flashing lights, caution, if you don't heed the warning, the fault is yours. Because adequate effort has been put out to make sure that you know that what follows does not catch you unaware. Luke chapter 12 is a warning. It is a parable about life, but it is not a life that we want to emulate. The setting of the parable that we're going to begin to consider in just a few moments, the actual discussion of that starts in verse 13. The parable itself starts in verse 16. But prior to that, the beginning of Luke chapter 12 tells us that Jesus is surrounded by crowds. In fact, the description that Luke gives is a large crowd, a crowd that is stepping on each other. They are trying to be near Jesus. It is a very big group. Jesus is trying to talk to his disciples. The text says they're trampling on one another. Whether this was chaotic or not, I don't know. But you've got a group here. Jesus is talking to his disciples, but there are many, many, many others who are there. And there's all kinds of discussions that are taking place. He's talking about the Pharisees, watch out for their hypocrisy. He's talking about how they will teach. He's talking about those who may have the opportunity to kill the body and persecute you, and you don't bother about them. Whatever Jesus says, I say in the darkness, you broadcast it from the rooftops. Don't be afraid of those who can take your life. And then one pops out. The 13th verse said, "Then one from the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me.'" I don't know if how this is described, that this is kind of a heckler's response. A quiet moment comes and somebody just calls out, "Hey, get my brother to divide the inheritance." Could have been. Or it may be that Jesus had a moment where this man had an opportunity to speak to him. Perhaps someone close by. But it's clear that it's not in the context of what Jesus is doing. This is an interruption. He deals with it. His first response, "Who made me a judge or an arbiter over you?" His question in our common language is, "What does this have to do with me? Why are you bringing this up to me? This is none of my business. I'm not involved in this." The idea of Jesus being a position of authority and for people looking to someone else for help is not uncommon. Why he chose Jesus on this particular topic, I don't know. The subject is interesting. Get my brother to divide the inheritance. If we're reading between the lines, the father is dead, the estate has been left, and this brother doesn't like the division of the property. You and I both know from our experiences of life that there have been many, many bitter fights over inheritance. Sometimes surviving families war for years over the division of property. I have seen families come apart because the survivors did not believe that whoever had passed on had properly divided the properties. That someone got too much, someone didn't get the right amount, that this one, I should have gotten that land or that house or that tractor or that whatever. Jesus uses it, however, to teach. His second response, after addressing the man, "How am I involved in this?" is to talk to his own disciples. And he tells them, in verse 15, "Take heed and beware of covetousness. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of the things he possesses." Three thoughts here. First, watch out, beware. There's a caution, a warning. There's something here that is dangerous, and that dangerous thing is covetousness. The second observation regarding covetousness itself is really what it is. How do we define covetousness? My guess is most of us are not afraid of that word. Although Jesus said, "Watch out, be aware," chances are we're not all that concerned about covetousness because of how we've defined it. How would you, and I would love for us to have an opportunity to have a conversation where we could go back and forth, but how would you define that term, covetousness? Is that something that you have an issue with? Is it in your life? Perhaps how we define it, there may be a number of ways that we have a mistaken notion about covetousness. One idea may be that we believe that in order to covet something or to be covetous, that it's something that must belong to somebody else, that somebody else has got it and I want it. Of course, there's ample awareness of this. When we go back to the book of Deuteronomy and we see in the second reading of the or giving of the law, verse 21, when Moses is giving the law there, he says, as the last commandment of the Ten Commandments, "Thou shalt not covet." And then describes, "You shall not covet your neighbor's wife." You don't just covet his house, his field, his servants, his animals. There's nothing that belongs to your neighbor that you should covet, that you desire these things. So we may understand that covetousness is only about what belongs to someone else. But it doesn't have to belong to anybody in order for you to covet. Achan coveted the items that he found in Jericho. It didn't belong to anybody. Those people were dead. They'd been killed. Now what was left had been dedicated to God. Achan coveted after the silver, the gold, the Babylonian garments. He took them, hid them along with his other property. It would cost him his life because he wanted these things. Another awareness that may sometimes be a problem is that we can only covet money. Clearly not the case, as we've already mentioned Achan. David coveted after Bathsheba. Now the problem there, perhaps we would say, well, that belonged to someone. That was Uriah the Hittite's wife. It wouldn't have been appropriate if that woman had belonged to no man. Then we also may think that covetousness is something that rich people have a problem with. The Lord then gives what I'll define as the key understanding for what follows. One's life does not consist in the abundance of the things he possesses. It's an attitude. The concept of covetousness is that this is something we desire and feel is worthy of life. And that is where then Jesus breaks into a discussion of the parable itself. I'd like for us to start reading in the 16th verse. Read through the material that is here, and then we'll come back and make observations concerning it. Then he spoke a parable to them, saying, "The ground of a certain rich man yielded plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, 'What shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops?' So he said, 'I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there I will store all my crops and my goods, and I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'Fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided?'" Now, there have been a lot of misunderstandings about this parable. Jesus did not condemn this man because he was wealthy. The fact that he was rich in and of itself is not a problem. The problem was his attitude toward those riches. Abraham was a rich man. Job was a wealthy man. Solomon certainly was a wealthy man. Solomon's displeasure from God was not because of his greed or his wealth. Rather, 1 Kings chapter 11 tells us that Solomon allowed women to turn his heart away from God, and that was his condemnation. Another problem that sometimes is looked at for this man is that he was ambitious. "I'm going to pull down the barns I've got and build bigger." I've known lots of individuals who were involved in small businesses whose businesses thrived, and they outgrew the places that they were, and they grew into a larger facility. I've known families, as they grow up, get older, as they have opportunity, that they are able to move out of a smaller home and into a larger home. Is that the problem that Jesus was describing here, that there's something wrong with tearing down what is smaller and going to what is bigger? No, again, that's not the issue. Then what is? I'd like to use as an understanding of the problem here another text to kind of use as a flashlight to shine a light onto the problems of this rich fool as he is described. And I want to use a passage from 1 Timothy chapter 6 to do so. 1 Timothy 6:17. It wasn't long ago that some of this material we talked about on a Wednesday night, but it fits perfectly, almost like a glove, to our discussion in Luke chapter 12. Paul in 1 Timothy chapter 6, as Paul is spending really much of the sixth chapter warning Timothy about the problem of material things. And he warns him earlier in the text, we brought nothing into this world, verse 7, it's certain we can carry nothing out, having food and clothing with these we shall be content. Watch out for materialism, Paul had been warning him. And then he comes to the discussion that Timothy was supposed to teach. Verse 17, command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, not to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Let them do good. Let them be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. Let's run that list as a checklist, shall we? And compare it to our rich fool. Command those who are rich in this present age that they should not be haughty. What did the rich man say? Was he looked at his crop and he surveyed his situation and he saw his material wealth? He said, I've got goods for years. I have arrived. I'm there, baby. I've got it. I don't have to work anymore. I have arrived. All I've got to do now is just sit back and enjoy my life. I've got so much stuff, all I need to do is just tear down these little barns, build bigger barns, and just sit back and enjoy. Oh yeah, he was haughty. There is a tendency of people to change the nature of their personality or character when certain circumstances happen to them. Chances are, at some point in your career, you have been involved with people in some business setting where an individual has been advanced from one area to another. Maybe they were a worker in the line or something and have been made a supervisor. And sometimes that change, going from one of the group up to a supervisory position, has an effect on how they treat other people, their mentality. They become puffed up. They get arrogant. I was watching a documentary on some musical groups, rock bands of the 80s. And one of the interviews was with some of the guys. And one of the guys said, one of the things that you're not prepared for when you become successful is the money and the fame. And he said, they mess with your mind. That was his wording. They mess with your mind. That suddenly you've got money and suddenly people know you and people want to be around you and your relationship with others has changed and you're different. He said, it's hard to be yourself. Well, what is yourself? Nor to trust in uncertain riches, number two. What did the rich man say? I now have all of these possessions. You have goods laid up for many years. All you've got to do is eat, drink, and be merry. He trusted in his wealth. It is probably difficult for us, any of us, to completely trust in God when we are provided for so well. We have what we need to eat. We have what we need to wear. We may have a good job. We may be surrounded by family. We may have pleasurable experiences. We live in a good home. We have automobiles to drive. The circumstances of our life may be fairly benign. And we may get to the point where we say, this is comfort that's been brought by my possessions. And we begin to trust in those things. Because I have money in the bank, because I've got health insurance, because I've got my house paid for, because you fill in the blank. Whatever it is that becomes the touchstone, the safety net, the perspective of I've got it made, I'm not at risk anymore because I've got all this stuff. warn those who are rich that they not trust in uncertain riches. Now, how is it that riches are uncertain? If you've got money in the bank, if you've got your house paid for, if you've got, and we can list our various assets, how are these uncertain? Thank you. That's exactly right. You never know what's going to come next. And isn't that the way life is? I remember a few weeks ago, not to make this too personal and certainly not to pick on the Rosenblum family, but I can remember a few weeks ago as we were talking about Pam and Carrie and Steve and Jamie and Martha going off to Nevis. Who of you imagined that Pam would get sick or come home sick from that event? Anybody in here? I sure didn't. I don't know what will happen tomorrow. I know what happened last week. When you got up last week, could you imagine a young man would have taken an automatic weapon and walked into a church and slaughtered nearly 10 people? I couldn't have seen that coming, could you? And I wonder about those folks, and I'm not, again, trying to put those on the spot and make them different. Jesus said when he was talking about those who were killed by the tower of Siloam that fell on them, he said, you think they were any more ungodly than anybody else? I tell you no, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. You think those people were more unrighteous than anyone else? You think they were any different than we are? You imagine the scene of someone standing up in the auditorium and starting to shoot at our brethren? I was having this conversation a couple of days ago with a man in the community, and he said, well, that could happen in your church. I said, no, it couldn't. He said, why not? I said, because I know five guys who'd shoot him dead on the spot. But yes, theoretically, we are not protected from the uncertainties of life. And if you believe that just because you've got all of these things in place, that you're safe and that you've got good things for years and you can expect the next 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 years or whatever and you're going to be okay, you don't know that you'll be okay. James says in James chapter 4, you don't know what will happen tomorrow. And we don't. And so if we put our trust in the material things of this world, we have trusted in something that is uncertain. But not in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. And here's the next problem of our rich fool. He did not understand where his wealth came from. He didn't know that God gave him all of those things. Where did this man believe life came from? We've got a lot of folks who live around us who are what they describe as atheists. They don't believe in God. That's okay. God believes in them anyway. God made them and God gives them life. God sends the rain on the just and on the unjust. God sends rain on believers and on atheists. God gives life to those who believe and those who don't believe. And their lives will continue to be sustained. But at some point, their time is going to come to an end. And they'll answer the same questions you are. What have you done with your life? Solomon said the conclusion of the whole matter in Ecclesiastes chapter 12 is this. God's going to bring every work into judgment, whether good or bad. Therefore, the conclusion is, seek God, keep His commandments. This is the whole duty of man. This man did not understand God. And he was looking strictly to a physical life. Paul goes on, let them do good that they may be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share. Go back and read about this our rich fool. What did he say? I have my goods, they are in my barns. I have me. He was not thinking about anyone around him except himself. He had become so self-absorbed. we have a word that is perhaps used too frequently, narcissism. It means to be focused solely on one's self. Same thing means, same basic concept as egotism, a little different in its expression. One is a self-love, the other is a self-promotion. This man was thinking about himself. And you know what Paul told Timothy to teach the brethren? He said, teach brethren to share, to give, to be willing to take what you have and give it to other people, to become rich, not in the possessions you own, but in what you do with them. And what did he do with them? He intended to spend them entirely, according to the parable that's given for us, on himself. And how did he look at his life? His life was there for his own pleasure and whatever he saw to do with it. And he had no concern about the next life to come. And so Jesus asks that question. God said to him, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided? Fool. That's what God calls him. A fool. Because he didn't understand. At the end of life, changes everything. There are lots of people who live around you who are only concerned with this life. They only think about here and now. And apparently they expect to live forever. And that was the problem of this man. And we're not going to live forever. I have a question to ask of you. If you're over 50, where are your grandparents? There may be a few of you, a handful, who still have grandparents living. Not many. Where are your great-grandparents? I just got us all. Now, except for the very young. Where are your great-great-grandparents? Now I got us all. You have grandchildren? You are their grandparents. We've just described what is going to happen to grandparents. You have great-grandchildren? You see, the certainty of life is that our lives are going to come to a conclusion. And if this life is the only life you're thinking about, then we have a problem. Verse 19 of 1 Timothy chapter 6. Storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come that they may lay hold on eternal life. All right. Some of you have been involved in financial transactions where you have to do a balance sheet. If you've ever done a business, you've had to do balance sheet, maybe for some other things as well. If you're taking out a business loan or something like that, you're going to have to do a workup of this sort. Let's just suppose that our balance sheet is going to have two columns in it. And in those columns, we're going to put the top column, and it's going to say material. And in the other column, it's going to say spiritual. All right. Let's talk about, and when you do a balance sheet, then you're going to have to talk about assets, those things that are for you, and then you're going to have to talk about those things that are not, your pluses and your minus. All right? So, we've got our balance sheet, and we've got it on the left side, and we look at our material things. What do you have that's an asset for you? What do you have that you still owe on? Those things that create a negative in your list. Our material things might work out to be pretty good. You say, well, at the end of this, I'm worth X amount of dollars. In the early part of one's life, if you fill out a balance sheet, it's often the case that you're worth more dead than alive because we usually have insurance to cover things along the way. In fact, it may be that a lot of people spend much of their life like that. But let's forget about the material side, the left side of that balance sheet for just a minute, and let's look over on the other side. How about your spiritual balance sheet? What are your assets with God? What are the treasures that you've laid up with God? What are the investments that you've made with God? What kind of eternal life and the foundation for eternal life that Paul was talking about in 1 Timothy chapter 6 have we made with God? The problem is that this man only thought about the material things and he didn't think about the spiritual things. He thought his balance sheet was in good shape, but it was only half good. The material side may have been in pretty good shape, but his spiritual side was the pits. And Jesus explained it to him. Said, you think you've got all this worked out? You think you have everything planned? You've got it all covered because you say, I've got stuff and I've got time and I've got health. Jesus says, let me tweak the numbers here just a second. And let's suppose for just a minute that your time has run out completely. That today is the last day. Now let's recalculate. You fool. This night your soul will be required of you. Then who will own all of those things that you used to claim? Because you won't. Where we read a few moments ago from 1 Timothy chapter 6, Paul said, we came into this world with nothing. We'll leave with nothing. The material things of this world are not the things of life. And that's where Jesus began. Life does not consist of the abundance of the things that we possess. Well, then what does life consist of, if that's the case? Last verse in Luke chapter 12, verse 21. So is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. Are you rich? You want to be rich? Most people probably would say no to the first and yes to the second. Are you rich? No. Most people don't claim that they're rich. Would you like to be rich? Yes, we mostly would. But when we do that, we're probably thinking physically. Here's a better question. Are you rich toward God? Do you even know how to calculate that? If you're rich toward God or not? I want to leave you with two readings. The first is from Matthew chapter 16, verse 26. And Jesus asks the question, what profit is it to a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his soul? And then I want to read the words of a song in our songbook, which really has been drawn from the same thought exactly. 741, if you want to see it. Not all earth's gold and silver can make a sinner whole. What shall it profit thee, O man, if thou shouldst lose thy soul? The heaping up of riches to many seems life's goal, but in the eager rush for wealth, forgotten is the soul. This solemn question answer, is worldly gain thy goal? Can fleeting riches be compared to an immortal soul? And then the chorus, what shall it profit a man? What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? And you know the answer to that question. From a worldly perspective, what people are looking for is what's here in the world. But Jesus said, you're a fool if you don't lay up treasure toward God. This world will come to an end. The physical things of this life that bring us comfort and that bring us opportunities are only here for us to use while we were here. And I'll say that again, for us to use while we're here. The things that we claim to possess, we don't own. You're going to leave them behind. It would be clearer to say you are in ability to use them, to manage them for a period of time, but they're going to be returned to he who owns them. And that is, all things will be returned to God. But from how we use the material goods God has put into our care, we will either have eternal life or not. The warning that Jesus gave in Luke chapter 12 should make it so that no person comes into judgment with a surprise, or no person faces the end of their life with a surprise who has heard the words of Jesus, "Tell the rich fool, you're foolish." As Christians, have we learned this lesson? The lesson is yours. Tonight it may be that you're not a Christian or that your life is not right with God and you need to make a change in your life. If you are not a child of God, God wants you to be one of His children. He gave Jesus Christ on the cross so that your sins could be forgiven. If you believe that Jesus is the Son of God and would make the confession before men that you believe in Jesus, you can be buried in water for the remission of your sins and added to the Lord's church even tonight. It may be that you're a child of God but not faithful. The invitation is for you. Tonight, if we can assist you spiritually, come as we stand and sing.
Is it for me, dear Savior?
Able to partake of the Lord's Supper this morning, it remains prepared for you. You can leave at this time and be shown where you can be served there in the lobby. Close with number 311. Number 311. It's not a song we sing often, if we sing it at all, and I don't sing it often, so we'll just struggle through it together. I'm kind of struggling tonight anyway, so we'll just struggle with one last song here. We'll try the first and second verse. We'll try the second verse if we do the first one well. Okay.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be His than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus. By His nail pierced hands.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given to us, and we thank you for all the many blessings. We ask that you be with those who are sick and unable to be here, and ask that you help them get well, and be with those who've lost loved ones, Lord, and comfort them as only you can. And we thank you, Lord, for letting us be able to come here and to worship you, to learn more about you today. And we ask that you help us to take the things that we've heard and to apply them to our lives, so that we are not so focused on just on the physical, but more on the spiritual, so that we can be better servants for you. Once again, we thank you for everything you've done for us. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen.